in victory. Did you hear him? Did you? Could, I said, good morning, victory. I want to make sure all of Homer hears y'all today. Welcome to our people that's following us online on Facebook. Let's give them a loud shout out for being on board. We love y'all back home. Thank y'all for staying safe. We hope to see y'all soon. Y'all ready to worship today? Welcome to all of our visitors. Let's get this worship on. I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my joy till I met you. I was breathing, but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my sin till I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave. Story. Y'all listen.
I needed rescue. My sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm
goodness. Always, Lord, always good to us, always so faithful, Lord.
All power, all authority is in your hands.
Jesus' name.
Is hidden within your glory, Jesus. My strength is in you. The odds are against me, but you are for me. Jesus, my strength is in you.
Goodness of God. I said the goodness of God. Ah, good morning, everybody. Thank you all. Y'all can have a seat. Relax. Hey, first of all, I just wanted to let y'all know that Melissa and I thank every one of y'all for your prayers over the last couple weeks. You know that I've been a little bit sick. I've been kind of out of it, and I really do appreciate, you know, just all the prayers that have been left uplifted for us. A few people have called and checked on us, and we really want to thank y'all for that. And I also want to encourage you to just continue to pray for the whole church body. We have a few people that have gotten sick over the few weeks, and just keep them in your prayers and lift them up. And saying that, that brings me back to those words, the goodness of God. You know, I wonder sometimes, do we really truly understand the depth of that and what that really means, the goodness of God? You see, it's our human nature sometimes to put our own definition onto God. And I think we really miss something when we do that. You see, the goodness of God is the same in the hills as it is in the valleys. The goodness of God is the same in the struggles and the blessings, the trials, the difficulties, the ease. It never changes. God's goodness never changes, regardless of our situations. You see, we want to define God's goodness based on our circumstances. And that's totally the wrong way to look at things. Because God's goodness never changes. You see, we have to remind ourselves that even when we're struggling, even when we're sick, God's with us. And He's still good. Amen? I really want to encourage everybody to just keep that in mind. And you know, no matter what's going on with our government, no matter what's going on with a pandemic, no matter what's going on with our jobs, our families, no matter what, God's with us. Amen? That should encourage every one of you all today. So at this moment, we want to go into our tithe and offering, and I want to say something really quick about tithes and offerings. You know, we talk about this every week, and the host will get up here, and they'll explain to you, you know, what we do with your donations and your tithes and how it helps the church, and we go on there. But one thing that I think we don't always talk about is what is the requirement of tithing? And if you read in the Bible, it actually has a little bit of a difference between the Old Testament and the New Testament. See, the Old Testament, there was a requirement, and the word tithe actually means 10%, a tenth of your first fruits, okay? And then as the New Testament comes, they don't really talk about the amount anymore, but Jesus says this, to give of a glad heart, meaning this, God does not want your offering if it causes you stress or frustration, if it causes you to be resentful, He'd rather you keep it. And we believe that very strongly here at Victory. We encourage you because God encourages you, and He asks for you to give of your first fruits. It's just a way of you showing God that you appreciate what He's given to you, and you give it back. But we only want you to do that if you can do that with a glad heart. Because otherwise, you're just ruining the blessing that God wants to give to you. Does that make sense to everybody? You know, look, money's tough. I get it. I've been there. I spent most of my life being consumed by money. And it caused me so much stress and so much pain and all kinds of stuff. And then I had to go through a very difficult thing in my life, and God made it so there was absolutely no way. I either had to give up my love of money or it would have destroyed me. And so I gave it up. And honestly, it was the greatest thing that ever happened to me. Was it hard during that time? Sure, of course it was. But look, what God did through that in my life and relieve that from me. It was me letting go of that and saying, you know what, God, you're in charge. And I guess that what it really all comes down to is, do you believe God's in charge? Because if you believe that God cares about everything about you, and that if you honor his request to give with a glad heart of your first fruits, and you believe he will honor you, it's the only thing in the Bible that God says, test me. The only thing in the whole Bible that he says, test me. So if you believe he'll do that, then you will give of a glad heart. Amen? Does that make sense? All right. So as the ushers go around, I just want to pray over that offering. Heavenly Father, Lord God, I thank you so much, Father, that you care even about the smallest details in our lives. And Father, as the congregation is just honoring you with what you've done in their lives, Father, I just pray a blessing over that. And Father God, that doesn't always mean financial. We know that. We understand that, Lord. We know, Lord God, that just a blessing from you, that you would provide for our needs in every one of them as we help those around the world that also are in need. Father, we love you for all you're doing. We love you for just the many blessings you've already given our lives and how you have protected us and guided us through even the difficultest times. We thank you. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. We're going to go into our news at this time, and then we'll get on with the sermon.
Welcome to Victor Roma. We're so glad you're here with us this morning. If you're a guest, please fill out a Connect card, which is located behind your chair. If you have any kids, please check them into VK Kids, which is located behind the main stage. Stay tuned for the rest of the news.
In Matthew 4:4, Jesus said, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." We believe that the Word of God is so important that we want to invite you to our Wednesday night Bible study. We meet every Wednesday except for First Wednesday at 7 p.m. Also, bring your children and your teens because we will have Victory Kids and the youth will be meeting upstairs for their service. Hope to see y'all on Wednesday.
We invite you to Growth Track. Growth Track is the first steps you take in serving here at Victory. If you would like to serve, please sign up in the foyer or contact one of our staff. We have many different areas where you can serve, such as greeting, coffee shop, media, VK Kids, youth, hosting, prayer team, ushers, parking, and photography. Please join us in serving here at Victory. Thank you and have a great day.
That's it for the news, guys. Make sure to follow us on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and Twitter. Thank you so much. You guys have a great day.
All right. Good morning. Again. How's everybody doing? Man, you know, it seems like a year since I seen y'all. In reality, it was last year, last time I saw y'all, right? Yeah, man, how's everybody's holidays? Everybody had a good time? Anybody had some time off at work? Yeah? Oh, that's good. That's good. Yeah? Yeah, Pat's over there. Yeah, I have every day off. Way to go. You reached that retirement age. Yeah, I had a little bit of time off, obviously. Not the way I wanted it to be, but, you know, I was out for a few days sick. And then last week, I actually, I worked from the house. I was feeling better, but, you know, just being cautious. You know, I think that we definitely trust that God can heal us. But that shouldn't just eliminate us also being smart about it, right? I mean, God does give us wisdom, and he gives us wisdom to do the right things. So, you know, that's the reason I was feeling a lot better last Sunday, but, you know, I had still just kind of gotten to the end of it, and I felt like, you know, just in caution, I care very much for everybody here, and I just out of caution, I decided to stay home another week, and Brother Todd stepped up, which I really appreciate him for that, kind of last minute, but he was ready. So and gave us the word last week. What y'all thought about that? Yeah, good, awesome. Yeah, I enjoyed it too. I was watching from the house. It was good. I really had a good time. But anyway, so I'm back, ready to go. We're starting a new series, as you can see, which I'll do it tomorrow. Now, when you read that, what is the first word that comes to your mind? Procrastination. Yeah, that's not what the message is about. at least not this week. It's actually about change. And who here knows that every single person who has ever been born or ever will be born will experience some sort of change in their life? Right? I mean, it's not unique to one person, is it? We all experience change. And there's really a lot of different kinds of change that goes in our life. Some of the change is good, or what we define as good, but that's kind of subjective as well, isn't it? I mean, what you think is good change, I might be completely against, you know? And I think that there's a lot of what we would call maybe universal change that would be considered good, where the majority of people would say, yeah, that's a good change. Or the majority of people would say, not so much, right? You know, I think that as we mature and we grow, most of us would consider that good change, right? Not very few people who have experienced some positive, good growth in their life would say afterwards, man, what a bummer. I really can't believe I had to change like that. I really enjoyed the way I was before, right? Most of us don't look at it that way, do we? I mean, most of us afterwards, even though if it was even a little bit painful, once it's over with, most of us would say, man, that was tough, but I'm really glad I went through that. All right? You know, and then, you know, there's other little changes that some of us like. You know, a promotion at work. Yeah, that's usually good. Although, I think there's probably more than one person who's been promoted and afterwards said, oh, no, man. I worked with a guy for a very long time. He actually retired from our company. But I can remember when I had first got hired with the company, he had just been promoted into a management position in the office and wasn't going offshore anymore. And he was over this office. And he did this for a few years. And then he said, forget that. Put me back in the field. I don't want this stuff anymore. He just didn't want to manage people, and that's hard. It's probably the hardest job there is to manage people. But he realized that promotion was not what he wanted, and he took a pay cut and a demotion and went back to the field, and that's where he was happiest. You know, so even something that most of us would consider a positive can actually be looked at as a negative, right? And you got all kinds of different kinds of, all of us change. People change. Even animals change, right? Governments change. Everything has changed. That's just part of life. You know, a lot of us would think that after a long winter, a nice spring day is a nice change, right? Also, here in Louisiana, after a long summer, a nice cool fall day is a pretty good change, right? You know, and then, of course, you know, maybe your team winning the Super Bowl. Okay, well, that's not really the best example for us here, but I love you all, Saints fans. But there is, and some change can be painful, right? It can be a kind of a negative. Most people who have ever been through a divorce don't afterwards think that that was a great change, even though maybe at the end of it and when it's done, you can look back and say, you know, I learned from that and I grew from that. But a loss of a marriage is difficult, even if it's the right thing to do, because it's an abusive relationship, for instance. And we have those where somebody is being abused. And, you know, even biblically, that's an acceptable reason in God's eyes for a divorce. Even through that, it's still a difficult change, right? And in reality, even the person who is being abused will be better off at the end. It's still a very difficult, hard change to go through, to separate themselves from that, right? Some of us have had children who have struggled or had some kind of traumatic accident. That's a hard change, especially as a parent, right? And the worst change, I can't imagine a worse change, is when a parent loses a child. You know, it's tough. You're not, as a parent, you never expect to outlive your children. And that's hard when you have to experience that. And some people have. And it's tough. It can be really hard, right? Change can bring happiness. It can bring sorrow. It can be joy. It can bring fear. It can bring all kinds of different emotions. But there's one thing about change that's really often overlooked. No matter how many times we experience it, we can sometimes overlook this aspect of change, and that is that sometimes change is deceiving. And what I mean by that is that sometimes when you think change was good, it can actually be bad. I want to give you an example. This was a change that was prompted by the WHO. Everybody knows what that is? The World Health Organization, okay? And it actually, now picture this. They had something happen that in the results of it, they actually had to drop cats into Borneo, all right? So in the early 1950s, there's a people called the Dayak people. They were people in Borneo, and they were suffering a malaria outbreak. So what the World Health Organization did is they had this solution. They said, what we're going to do is we're going to spray large amounts of DDT so that they could kill all the mosquitoes. Now, when they did this, it killed the mosquitoes. The malaria cases went way down, and they were applauding themselves. Wow, look what we did. What a great thing. Well, and it was good for a while. But then there were some unexpected side effects. First of all, the roofs of all the people's houses began to fall down on their heads. Because it seems that this DDT also killed a parasitic wasp, which had been previously controlling the thatch-eating caterpillars. That's what the roofs were made out of. It's like hay, right? These caterpillars will eat that. But the wasp controlled the caterpillars. When the wasps were killed by the DDT, the caterpillars went rampant and started eating all of the thatch, and the roofs were falling on people's heads. Okay? Worse, that DDT poisoned the insects, which were then ate by the geckos, and those were eaten by cats. And then the cats started dying out. When the cats started dying out, then the rats started flourishing. And when that happened, now the people, the Dayak people, had a huge outbreak of typhus and plague. Now, I'm no health expert, but I'm pretty sure I would much rather try to make it through a malaria case than plague. It just doesn't sound like a good swap to me, right? So once that plague started going rampant, they had to cope with that problem, which their solution had actually created. So the World Health Organization was obliged to parachute 14,000 live cats into Borneo. It's called Operation Cat Drop. Now, this Operation Cat Drop has actually been pretty much forgotten by most people. But it's this graphic illustration of all the interconnectedness of life, right? Where one act can actually have adverse effects in other areas that you might not even perceive. And the root of the problem sometimes stems from our proposed solutions. And in retrospect, it's very obvious that if they had just allowed the malaria to work its course, it would have been a lot less adverse than their solution actually created. Now, I don't think we've learned a lot from that. And I think that we're repeating history. But anyways, the point is that sometimes when a change looks like it's a good change, in reality, it can turn out to be something much worse. But it also goes the other way, too. Sometimes when a change happens in our lives, in our families' lives, our friends, our community, sometimes in the beginning it looks like not very good. And then in reality, it can turn out to be much better. Now, when I say things like that, I can't help but to think or wonder how many people here are thinking that I'm alluding to the elections. In reality, I'm not. I wrote this message weeks ago, and I had no thoughts whatsoever of what's going on in our government, okay? You can apply it any way you feel. That was not my intentions. I will reserve my opinion at the moment of whether that change is good or not. I think that no matter which side you're on, no matter whether you voted for President-elect Biden or you voted for President Trump, whether you think this is right or isn't right, the fact of what it's doing to destroy our nation can't be a good thing. And that's from both sides. We've got to find a way to heal this nation. And I'm telling you all right now, that's never going to happen until people, the church, starts being a better example to the lost. We are called to be the light to this world. We are called to do that. God has made us in his image, and we know the saving grace of Jesus Christ. And unless we are willing to start showing that to all sides and find common ground once again, we're going to struggle in this nation. See, sometimes we can see changes in a negative light, but we don't really actually realize until later that it's good. But one thing is very certain about change. Change is going to happen. Whether we will it or not, it's going to happen. Sometimes it's going to be good. Sometimes it won't. King Solomon talked about this in the book of Ecclesiastes. And I say King Solomon, but actually they're not really 100% sure who wrote Ecclesiastes. It mentions in there about the son of David, so you would assume that would be King Solomon. However, some of the verbiage that he uses is a little bit more common, and wouldn't be quite fitting for a king to speak that way. So there's some discrepancies. But anyways, it's a very good book, and it's really worth understanding, because one great thing about Ecclesiastes is it's a book a lot like the book of Job. It refuses to dodge the hard questions of life. And it's really, it doesn't allow for easy solutions either. It really will challenge you to read through it and then explain and talk about it afterwards. Because it's not a simplistic book. It's very deep. But it's good, and it's worth digging into. And if you've never read the book, I really encourage you to read it. Do a Bible study on it. You know, there's nothing, I guess, more enlightening in our lives than when we dig into God's Word, even the tough parts of it. And let's be honest, not everything in the Bible is easy. It's not always easy to explain, especially to people who already don't believe. But it's challenging, and challenges are good, right? So it's a book I encourage you to read. But anyways, we're going to read, if you have your Bibles, opened up to Ecclesiastes chapter 3. And we're going to read verses 1 through 8. To everything there is a season, and a time to every purpose under the heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck up that which is planted. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to get and a time to lose. A time to keep and a time to cast away. A time to rend and a time to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time of war and a time of peace. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this morning. I thank you for the opportunity, Lord, that we have to come together and hear your word. Lord, just give us wisdom and understanding of what you have us to know during this, and let us apply it to our lives and be that light to the world that so desperately needs it. We love you and pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, I think that everybody that it should be a law, and I'm just going to advocate this right now, that we make a new law that before you post on social media, you have to read these verses, okay? Because honestly, if people would read just the one part in verse 7 that says, a time to keep silent and a time to speak, I really think our nation could be in a whole lot better condition than it is right now. Amen? Look, man, all of us do it. We do. Every one of us do it. But we just sometimes people speak when they really should be silent. And then sometimes people are silent when they really should speak. And it's tough to know when that time is to be silent or to speak, especially when it's about a subject matter that causes an emotional response. When you are emotionally aroused into feeling something, it's hard to keep your mouth shut. And sometimes it's hard to speak, right? Because our emotions can guide us sometimes. Our emotions can direct our path. And oftentimes when you react emotionally, these verses intellectually, you'll make a mistake. Because your emotions are so strong, right? And sometimes our emotions cause us to react inappropriately, or they keep us from reacting appropriately. So I really think that that verse, and I was just thinking about it as I was reading that to you, that thought came into my mind that, man, sometimes I think we just need to do a better job of being quiet or a better job of speaking, right? And I think that, especially as the church, y'all, I cannot say it enough. I say it all the time, and I'm going to keep on saying it, but I just can't say it enough about how much the church needs to start being the church in this nation. We need to be that example. If we're not the example, somebody else will be. And do we really need some of the people that are being the example in this country to be the example? We need to be that example, y'all. We know. God has shown us. He's talked to us. He's been the example to us. We've got to be that example, people. And we got to stop letting some of the people that are being the example be that example. Our children learn so much by the examples they are presented. Do you really want some of the people that are being the example to our children to be their example? I know I don't. You can't hardly watch television anymore without having some kind of just horrific examples be shown to our children, and in young children, too. Yeah, nobody's safe anymore when it comes to television. You've got to weed that through. That's your responsibility as the parents. You've got to weed through that stuff. Spend some time and research it. Don't just plop your children in front of the television, turn it on, and let them have free reign. Guys, they're going to see things they should never see. And they're going to see it young. We were watching a show, and I don't remember what the show is, but our granddaughter, our youngest grandchild, she's just barely one. She's not quite one yet. And she was watching this little TV show, and Melissa made a comment to me that really stuck with me. And she says, you know, this was a really good show, and it used to be that 4-, 5-, and 6-year-olds would enjoy that show. But it's too childish for them now. And when she said that, I didn't really respond to her at the moment, but I've been thinking a lot about that. What does that mean? What that means is our children, in some aspects, are growing up so fast because they're being exposed to things at such a young age that they should never be. The problem is that when it comes to things like responsibility, they're not growing up at all. That's why you have adult children who live at home and don't have any contribution to anything, because they're not willing to grow up yet. But yet they know so much. It's an anomaly that's never been seen before, but it's being seen now, and it all comes from things like social media. They get exposed to stuff at such a young age, but they don't get taught responsibilities. And it's tough. It's tough. The writer of Ecclesiastes knew that the change that sets deep at the heart of life, what that means to us. He said in chapter 3, for everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven. And then he goes on to state different seasons of the life. He says, a time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to pluck what is planted. See, he's describing war and construction and mourning and celebration. He's talking about all different kinds of aspects of our life that we go through. There was an Old Testament scholar, J. Stafford Wright. He said, man is to take his life day by day from the hand of God, realizing that God has fitting time for each thing to be done. God has a time for everything, and we should take that understanding and that direction from God, not from society. In the midst of change, Christians should recognize that each moment is a God-given moment. Every moment is a moment given by God. We're not promised one single second. Not one. And we need to live in recognition of that fact. That's my prayer for you. That each and every day you live your life regardless of and in spite of the changes as a gift from God. Because every moment is a gift. I want to encourage you to with some basic steps that I think that can help you with this. The first one is, be thankful in all things. Be thankful in all things. If we want to understand the depth of what James said when he wrote in James chapter 4, let's look at verses 13 to 15. Come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we will get into such and such a town and spend a year there and trade and make a profit, yet you do not know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? For you are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. See, one of the things I think that prevents us from being thankful in everything is that we think we have time to make wrong or make right those things that are wrong. See, what prevents us from being thankful in the moment is that we think, well, that's okay. I got time. I can do that later. I can come back to that. You with me? Yeah, you with me so far? All right. See, anyone that has ever had a life-ending, threatening experience will often tell you the same thing, that it caused such great clarity. See, they were maybe near death, and it gave them an understanding about things, a life. They realized that they spend far too much time concentrating on matters that shouldn't even concern them. Too much time being concerned about those little things that don't matter, and not enough time being concerned about the things that really do matter. And that can be disorientating to them because they come to realize through this near-death experience that, what have I done with my life? Why was I ever worried about all those things? Why did I spend so much time concerned about those things in my life? When in reality, now that I'm on death's bed, I don't even care about those things at all. So why did I care about them when I was healthy, when I wasn't, my life wasn't being threatened? It gives them a realization. I wonder about you, if you think it to yourself, what do I really care about? What in my life really matters? And am I thankful for those things? Do we ever consider that? See, maybe perhaps you've lost your job during this struggling economy that we have, or maybe you've lost your health, or you might even have lost a loved one. And those circumstances can be very tremendously difficult for us, can't they? But even so, do you still realize how much you have to be thankful? Do you still realize how much God has done? I want you to look at me with about a story of a man who had every right to be bitter, but he wasn't. The next footsteps in the corridor he knew might be those of the guards taking him away to his execution. His only bed was the hard, cold stone floor of the dank, cramped prison cell. Not an hour passed when he was free from the constant irritation of the chains and the pain of the iron manacles cutting into his wrists and legs. Separated from friends, unjustly accused, brutally treated. If ever a person had a right to complain, it was this man, languishing almost forgotten in a harsh Roman prison. But instead of complaints, his lips rang with words of praise and thanksgiving. The man was the Apostle Paul, a man who had learned the meaning of true thanksgiving, even in the midst of great adversity. He had experienced the most drastic change anyone short of Jesus Christ himself had ever experienced. He started as a trusted, honored member of one of the most powerful religious sects in all of the Jewish community. And now he's locked in prison for a crime that he never committed. He never did anything wrong. But yet he was imprisoned. Earlier, when he had been imprisoned in Rome, he wrote in Ephesians 5:19-20, sing and make music in your heart to the Lord. always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. I wonder how many of us, while being unfairly locked up in prison, would write words like that. Sing and make music in your heart. Give thanks to God for everything. He is saying that I thank God even for being imprisoned. We've seen similar responses. Stephen was being beaten and stoned and prayed, God, forgive them, for they know not what they do. While being stoned to death, prayed on behalf of the people stoning him. We also have the apostles, that Peter and I think it was John, that was being beaten in front of the religious leaders. They were beaten for speaking about Jesus and then told, do not say his name again. And they went out rejoicing and clapping and singing, saying, we thank you, God, that we could be beaten for you. How many of us would respond like that? We get upset and complain when we get sick. Or when things are a little bit trying or difficult. I'm pretty sure nobody in here has ever been stoned. At least not on purpose. I did accidentally hit a friend with a stone once. It was, we were kids in grade school, and I don't know why we did it, but we decided to throw stones at each other and see how close we could get without hitting. I missed, meaning I actually hit him in the eye, and then his older brother almost beat me up, so. Yeah, but outside of that, I don't think there's too many people around here that are getting stoned, right? And yet these people rejoiced for that. See, thankfulness should be a natural response as a believer. We should just, it should be just natural for us, like breathing or eating, to be thankful. We shouldn't even have to think about it, knowing how much God has done for us, knowing what he has done, how much he has poured out to us every day, every hour, every minute, every second, every moment that we have with our loved ones is a gift from God. Every single moment. So thankfulness should just be a natural response to God's love, what he's shown to us. We have experienced the most perfect love from Jesus Christ that could ever be experienced. The most perfect love. When you think about it, being thankful in times of change should be so natural to us. Think about the change of you coming to know the saving grace of Jesus Christ. If you would remember just that one fact, you should be thankful in all things. But he's done so much more than that. But there is a risk that many of us face. And actually a few risks, but there are a couple of them I want to share with you when it comes to us being thankful. The first thing is we can become complacent. It can interfere with us being thankful when we become complacent of what's happened to us. Complacency is defined by the Merriam-Webster Dictionary as self-satisfaction, especially when accompanied by unawareness of actual dangers or deficiencies. See, in other words, we become pleased with ourselves because of the lack of trouble. Meaning we quickly forget that God, everything that God's done to us, because everything's going so well. And we forget about those things. You would think that this would be a slow process too, wouldn't you? And it can. It can creep in little by little. But I think in most cases it happens really quickly. I've hired quite a few people at our company. And I've seen this happen so many times. You hire a person, they come to work, and they're willing to do anything. Absolutely anything. They're so happy that they have a job. They so appreciate the opportunity. Anything you want them to do, yes, sir, absolutely. Yeah, I can do that. I volunteer, do it, help it. And then after a while, it's like somebody flips a light switch on them. And then they're like, it ain't my job. Well, why I got to do it? They ain't doing it. Well, this ain't fair. And then they're sitting around, and then their breaks seem to get longer and more often. And pretty soon it's like you're trying to make them realize that they should be happy they have a job. And they act like they're guaranteed it, you know. It's just strange. And that can be dangerous, actually. That kind of mentality can be dangerous in the wrong climate. Consider the infamous example of the Deepwater Horizon. It killed 11 people, and it injured another 126, and it caused an oil spill that took 3 months to get under control. We in Louisiana know how bad that was for our economy and what it did for our fishing industry. Just that alone, how much it hurt. According to a federal report, the catastrophe was the result of poor risk management, last-minute changes to plans, failure to observe and respond to critical indicators, inadequate well control responses, and insufficient emergency bridge response training. In a nutshell, complacency. Complacency. But as bad as complacency is, there's something that's far worse, and that's an ungrateful heart. An ungrateful heart. Nothing turns into bitter, selfish, dissatisfied people more quickly than an ungrateful heart. In the ancient world, leprosy was a terrible disease. People that became lepers were shunned. They were made forced out of the community, and they had to live in leper communities. They were not allowed to come by anybody. And if anybody was walking on the road towards them, they would have to shout out to them and tell them and warn them that they were lepers before they approached, to give them the opportunity to turn to the side so that they didn't come anywhere near them. They were abandoned and shunned by family, friends, loved ones, and the community in general. And they were left to fend for themselves. The only thing a leper ever really wanted was to be healed so that they could come back into the community and be part of all of that. There's a story in the Bible where 10 lepers approach Jesus outside a village, and they're loudly pleading with him to heal them. In an instant, he restores all 10 of them to perfect health. But do you know that only one of those lepers came back to thank him? Only one. The other 9, they left without a word of thanks. Why? Because their minds were preoccupied on themselves, and they were gripped with a spirit of ingratitude. Today, too, ingratitude and thanklessness are far too common in our community. Children forget to thank their parents for everything that they do for them. Common courtesy is sometimes scorned. We take for granted the ways that others help us. Above all, we fail to thank God for all his blessings in our lives. Ingratitude's a sin, just as surely as lying or stealing or immorality or any other sin condemned by the Bible. One of the Bible's indictments against rebellious humanity is found in Romans 1st chapter. Romans chapter 1, verse 21 says, although they knew God, they never glorified him as God, nor gave thanks to him. An ungrateful heart is a heart that's cold toward God and indifferent to His mercy and His love. It's a heart that has forgotten how dependent we are on God for everything. From one end of the Bible to the other, we're commanded to be thankful. In fact, thankfulness is the natural outflow of a heart that is attuned to God. The psalmist declared in Psalms 147:7, "Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving." And Paul wrote in Colossians 3:15, "Be thankful." See, thankfulness is always a mark of a joyous Christian. It's a natural response. Why should we be thankful? Because God has blessed us. And we should be thankful for every blessing. The best example I can give for you being thankful, even in the midst of change, for everything that God has done, by showing you the kind of impact that should have on a person, on our lives. See, an ungrateful person will never positively impact others. How could they? How could you ever give and help others when you're ungrateful for what you have? You won't. But a grateful person, that's a whole different story. Let's watch this.
I have a lot of memories from when I was a child. One that's always stuck out to me, though, was when I was about 10 years old, and I was in school, and I struggled. And I didn't struggle with English, math, or science. I struggled holding still. And I would try to listen and focus and process ideas, but I couldn't help myself. And to be honest, I would sit there and then I would just start tapping. And the students in the class would look at me and they'd say, "Hey, stop tapping." A lot of the time, I didn't even realize I was doing it. And then eventually even the teachers got after me and they would yell at me and they'd say, "Clint, you have to stop tapping." It got so bad that I got sent to the principal's office for tapping. And he said to me, "Okay, maybe when you go back to class, just try sitting on your hands." So I did. I went back to class, and when I felt myself starting to tap, I did this. I sat on my hands, and that worked for about 5 seconds. One time I was tapping in class, and my teacher, Mr. Jensen, looked at me, and he yelled. And he said, "Clint, stay after class." And I thought to myself, this is it. I am done. Now, I've always been the type of person that believes that a single moment in time can change a person's life. And this was one of those moments for me, and I will never forget it. So I was sitting there with Mr. Jensen and an empty classroom. And he walked past me and he sat next to his desk and he said, "Clint, come here, I want to talk to you." And as he looked me right in the eye, he said, "Now, I need you to know something, you're not in trouble. But I do have just one question that I have to ask you." He said, "Have you ever thought about playing the drums?" And in that moment, Mr. Jensen, he leaned back and he opened the top drawer of his desk. And he reached in and he pulled out my very first pair of drumsticks. And he held them in his hands and he looked at me and he said, "Hey, Clint, you're not a problem. I think you're a drummer." Drums all over the world. My whole college education was paid for with drumsticks in my hand. Just because of a single moment in time when somebody believed in me and he saw something in me that I didn't even see within myself. And from that moment, I learned that there's a difference between being the best in the world and being the best for the world.
Never miss a day or a moment to thank God for everything. You have an opportunity in certain situations to make a difference. And when you run across a situation like that, you will make a difference, one way or the other. What kind of difference will you make? It'll be your choice. And as funny as it may sound, we should even be thankful in the midst of our troubles. When you suffer for Jesus' name, you are truly blessed. Amen. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you so much. First, Father, for your grace and your mercy. I thank you for your patience. Lord God, we don't always get it right. We don't always make the right choices. We're not always the best example. But Lord, as we focus on you, as we are thankful for every change that comes in our lives, because we know, Lord God, no matter what the change is, no matter how difficult it may seem, no matter how trying it is, we know that you can use it for good. We don't always see how the future will play out. We don't always understand how something good could come through certain situations, but you know, and we trust you, Lord. I pray, Father, that every single day, every moment, every situation, that we thank you for that opportunity to be used by you. Let us be that light, Lord, that this world so desperately needs. Let us be the example, Father, that this nation is crying out for. Let us just share what you have already shared with us. Let us be love when there's so much hate. Let us be thankful when there's so much animosity. And Lord, use us to reach our community, our families, our friends, this nation. I thank you so much, Lord God. I thank you for your mercy in our lives. If there's anybody here today that you have never made that commitment, you have never accepted his offer of grace, I ask that you just raise your hand right now and let us just pray for you. Or if you maybe stepped away, fallen back, you've forgotten what it is to be used by him, raise your hand. Thank you. We're just going to pray with you. It's so simple. What we do is so simple. It may just seem like words, but it's not just the words that you're about to speak as you pray with us. It's the change in your heart. Your willingness to surrender your will and allow God to work in you. So as we say, and if you're online also watching today and you're ready to make that commitment, just repeat after me. And the church is going to say this with us. So repeat these words. Heavenly Father, I choose you. Lord, forgive me for my sins and my failures. Today, I will serve you. I accept you, Lord, as my Lord and Savior. Let your will be done instead of mine. I ask for your wisdom and your guidance going forward. And when the enemy attacks, I pray your protection. Heavenly Father, I love you. And in Jesus' name, I thank you. Amen. Ah, let's give him a round of applause. If you made that choice today, And we just want you to know that we're here for you and we will walk with you. And if you have any questions at all, please just get with us. We'll gladly help you any way we can. And if you don't have a Bible and you need one, let us know. We'll get one for you. But if there's any parts at all, in trials, you need to understand that when you make that choice, the enemy's going to attack you. He's not going to make it easy. He's going to first try to deceive you. He's going to try to convince you that you didn't do anything, that you're no different. That's a lie. That's a lie. You are now a child of God. You have received his gift. You are changed. You are different. Don't allow the enemy to lie to you. And if you need and have any questions or just need us to pray with you. And at that, I also want to take this moment to, I just want to pray over any needs that we have here. So I just want to take a moment. We've done this before. I'd like to do this again where if you have, I just want to ask if anybody here has any needs or prayers in the form of health, whether it's for yourself or somebody else. You just need a prayer, you know, maybe you're sick or maybe you are suffering from something or you have a family member. Just raise your hand right now. Anybody, hands all over. Let's just pray over that at this moment. Heavenly Father, Lord, I am just asking you, Lord God, in Jesus' name, to heal every one of these requests. Lord God, I'm just asking for a supernatural healing at this moment, right now, Lord God. That you would just step in, Father God, and you would heal every single person or their members or family. You know the situation, why every person raised their hand right now. And I'm praying, Lord God, as we stand in confirmation and claim in Jesus' name, Lord God, the healing supernaturally in their bodies. Father, we love you. We pray that in Jesus' name. I also want to take a moment and just pray. And anybody has any kind of financial need, you know, whether it's just financials in your house, whether it's a job, whatever it is, any financial needs right now, if you have that, raise your hand right now. If anybody you know has that, you want to pray and ask for prayer on their behalf, raise your hand right now. We're going to pray over that. Heavenly Father, Lord God, I lift up every one of these prayer requests to you. Heavenly Father, Lord, I am asking, Lord, where a door may have been closed, that it be open. Heavenly Father, we're just asking that you just pour a blessing out on every one of these needs. Lord, you know every situation. You know what their financial needs are. Lord God, if their financial needs has become a result of a poor choice in our life, we're praying, Father, that they have wisdom and understanding how to be more faithful in what you have given them. How to use your blessings that are in. Father, you have said that when we are faithful with the little, you will trust us with more. So I'm praying that in every situation. If it's not anything to do with them, just circumstantial, we're praying that changes right now, Lord God. Father, that you would change every one of those circumstances. And Father, that they would have a blessing poured out on them and their financial needs met. Father, we know the difference between a want and a need, and we are praying for the needs. We love you. We pray that in Jesus' name. I also want to ask right now if there's any other kind of prayer request, maybe an unspoken prayer. Maybe it's a fact of, you know, maybe you're just struggling with difficulty. Maybe you just want to pray for our nation. Maybe you want to pray for the community. Maybe you want to pray for this church. We're asking, Lord, that as much as the economy is going, it affects everything. It affects the church. And we're asking, I'm asking that you can pray with me over our finances here at the church. The board and I are going to meet on Tuesday to discuss that and figure out how to deal with that. The board works tirelessly when it comes to the finances of this church. They all are volunteer people, and they just give a lot trying to figure out and be faithful with the money we receive. So I'm asking you to pray for them in their decision-making that we would always be faithful with what we have and that God would provide for us. But if there's any other needs that somebody might have, just raise your hand right now. We're going to pray over all those needs. Heavenly Father, Lord God, we just ask and lift up every one of these requests, no matter what that request is, Lord God, because you have said that you care for even the smallest of details. Lord God, it doesn't matter how small or minor it is. You love us so much that you care for that. I want to lift up every single request. And if there's anybody watching online that has a need, has a request, Father, we're just asking for that as well, Lord God. We are standing in faith. You have said where two or more are gathered, you are there, Lord God. Father, we know your presence is here. Father, we are just asking that you intervene and step into every situation, Lord God, and your perfect will be done. Not what we desire, but only what we need, Father, that you know the best way for that to be answered, and we're asking that that just be poured out on every single person today. We love you so much, and we pray that in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. Let's give God a round of applause. We are so thankful for everything that he does in our lives and in this church. And I want to thank every one of you today. But before we go, we're going to sing another song. Let's just stand to our feet. Let's just worship the Lord one more time. Amen.
Savior, I felt fire from above. I've been down to the river. I ain't the same, a prodigal return. I'm not going back, I'll never be the same. That's why I sing, all my hope is in Jesus. Thank God my yesterday's gone, and all my sins are forgiven, and there's a kind of thing that you breaks a man. Break him down to his knees. God, I've been broken more than a time or two. Yes, I have. And he picked me up. And he showed me what it means to be a man. Come on and sing, oh. Hope is in Jesus. Thank God that yesterday is gone. All my sins are forgiven, and I've been washed by the blood. Come on and sing it with me. Jesus, thank God my yesterday. 'cause I've been washed by the blood.
Right, all right. As you can tell, I'm pulling double duty today. Oh, that's all right. That's good stuff, though. Listen, I just want to encourage y'all. I'm not going to take up a lot of your time. I just want to encourage y'all. Go out into this week. Just spend this week, right? Don't worry about next week or next month or any of those things. Just concentrate on this week. And every single day, just look and try to recognize every moment that you see God working in your life. See, I think one of our biggest problems is that our busyness, right? Our busyness distracts us. And we have a tendency to not recognize those small little details that God is working in our lives. So let's just be very purposeful this week into looking at every situation and moment and recognizing what God has done. And if you're somebody who does do Facebook or Twitter or any of those other medias and you want to post something, post what God did for you in that moment. Share and encourage other people. If we could do that more often, we really will see change in our communities. Amen? All right. Let's pray and we'll dismiss. Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, for this day. I thank you, Lord, for your message. I thank you for your word. Most importantly, Lord, I thank you for your love, your grace, and your mercy. Heavenly Father, we too oftentimes don't recognize just how much you are doing in our lives. We have a tendency to take it for granted, become complacent, even ungrateful. And I'm praying, Lord God, that this week that we recognize every single moment that you are there, every moment that you work in our lives, and we just share that. Let us be that light you've called us to be. I thank you for every member here. I pray, Lord, as they go home and as they're traveling, just put a hedge of protection around them. I pray for healing in all those members that have been sick, that they'll be back with us soon. Lord God, I continue to pray for your guidance and just pray that you just pour out your blessing on every member here. We love you. We thank you. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, love on somebody, and we'll see y'all next week. Make sure you invite your friends and family. Amen.